You're listening to the Inquisitive Rent Podcast, the show that brings you philosophical ponderings of your life from a bird's eye view. Now, here's your host, Shah.
Donna McGeorge is a productivity author and speaker. She has written 10 books and has over 20 years of training and coaching. Her latest book in the It's About Time series, titled The One Day Refund, Take Back Time and Spend It Wisely, has been featured in Forbes as part of the books to help you to regain momentum in the new year. Donna has worked with companies such as Nissan Motor Company, Ford Motor Company, Qantas, Ernst Young, and others. Productivity speaks to my soul, and I'm always juggling life and work. And Donna gives some very practical advice on how to structure your day using studies based on neuroscience. I'm so happy to speak to her today, so let's welcome Donna. Welcome, Donna. Nice to see you. Glad you're here.
Thank you so much, Shah, for having me on your show. I really appreciate it.
Now, you are known as the productivity coach, and I absolutely love that. Before I ventured into counseling and therapy, I worked in the corporate world a lot. I did a lot of different things, but one of the things that excites me is productivity. And I always wondered about people and how they structured their days. And, you know, I sometimes go in and people say, I'm so tired before we even started work. And it always intrigued me how people felt tired. I'm quite a morning person. I've always known that. Maybe in my 20s, I wasn't, because I was clubbing, early 20s. However, I got up and went to work. So I want to start out by saying that your work speaks to me in that respect. But, you know, we're at a time in this world right now where people are changing the way they work. And I want to ask you about that. Has some of your work been influenced by world change and how we are all having to change how and when and how we structure our work?
Absolutely, is the short answer. Before I get into the long answer, I have to tell you that I don't think anyone in their 20s is a morning person, just quietly. I'm with you about that as well. I think most people in their 20s stay up late and sleep late and, you know, seem to need gazillions of hours of sleep. So we have that in common. In terms of the influence of my work, yes, I think certainly the first two books that I wrote in the It's About Time series were probably as a result of my experience of working in corporate generally. But this last one, which is called The One Day Refund, was all in response to, you know, the pandemic, dealing with lockdowns. So down here in Australia, you probably are aware, we had some of the strictest lockdowns in the world. I was fully participating in all of that. And it began to really change how people thought about work, their hours. And we're seeing that now as, you know, they're calling it the great resignation. I don't know really what it's called, the great reshuffle, the great reset, whatever you want to call it, as people are making different decisions now about how they want to work. And I'm thrilled to see more conversations now about this idea of four-day work weeks or compressed work weeks, as people acknowledge that they do work long hours anyway, so we may as well pay them for that. And secondly, that we actually need more time to recover. There's so much going on in our world right now that we need more time to rest and recover. So probably this last book was a indirect response to some of the stuff I was seeing about changing workplaces over the last 2 years.
Excellent. And we're going to talk about your books in a moment. But you know, this whole 24-hour clock thing, I like that in your books, you do refer to neuroscience and think this is right up my alley. But, you know, the ancient Egyptians, you know, they sort of made up this 24-hour clock based on the constellations, or maybe it was stars, because I know there's different constellations, group of stars. Sorry, astrologists out there, and, you know.
Don't at us.
Please don't. But, you know, they got this idea of, I think, 10 hours in the morning, 12 hours in the evening or something. It was kind of how we got around to the 24-hour clock and day and night. And you do refer to that a lot, that, you know, the research shows that human beings are a lot more proactive mentally. They can ingest more information, remember it, act on it, during the morning times rather than the evening times where we're a bit more physically active. Perhaps that's why gyms are so full in the evenings after work as well. However, I just wondered what drew you to that idea about how we work and what, because some people talk about being night owls and all that. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, that is all as a result of hearing people say over the years, I seem to be getting a lot done. I seem to be, you know, ticking all the things off my to-do list, but I'm still getting to the end of the day and I'm exhausted. And so, you know, we've been told for a really long time that you got to focus on what's urgent and important, and urgency should drive. I actually drive your activity, really. And I think it's a bit weird now when everything's urgent. So we live now in an urgency epidemic. Everything's urgent, everything's urgent. So what happens when everything's urgent? How do you now decide what you do? So I started doing the research around circadian rhythms and body clocks and discovered that for most of us, our bodies are designed for mental alertness in the morning and physical dexterity in the afternoon, as you mentioned. And that there are good times to do various things. So you talked about the gym being booked out in the evenings or busy in the evenings. And that's actually because that's the best time of day for exercise. Having said that, if you want to lose weight, the best time is the morning, right? And so there's good times for, there's the right time for eating certain things. And when it came to work, there was a better time than others to do certain things. So I know that some of your listeners might gasp a bit at what I'm about to say, but things like email, for example, are better for the afternoon than the morning. And yet we spend our whole morning and sometimes our whole day immersed in our email. So this largely came around because of this idea that people are like, how come I'm getting everything done and I should feel good, but I actually feel exhausted, tired and overwhelmed and still feel like I'm not doing the right things.
Yeah, absolutely. Interesting that. Isn't it? Because I think we, and you refer to this as well, we can sometimes get into our own minds about, you know, we think we're evening, we think we're night owls, but, you know, is your life being lived that way? You know, are you making that up? I know that musicians, my cousin was a musician and he worked in the evening a lot and most of his studio time was booked in the evening. And I suppose they too make that up. Why can't they work more in the daytime? And they say, he used to say, well, I'm up until, you know, I'm up until 2 p.m. And then he sleeps, you know, from 5 till, I don't know, midnight until he gets up again. So it's just the way we design our life, I suppose.
Yeah, and the thing about night owls is there are a small amount of us that actually are natural night owls. They are a bit of an evolutionary anomaly, if you want to think about it that way, because for everyone else, you know, we're designed to go to sleep when it gets dark and wake up when it gets light. And it's our melatonin production that makes that happen. That's what we're actually designed for. So anyone that's a night owl may have that messed up a little bit. That could very well be a chemical imbalance. Or it could be, as you say, it's self-created. Mm. So what came first, the musician or the night owl? So my daughter is also a musician. However, she doesn't work at night. So she can, you know, she runs a perfectly normal day with how she does her music. Yet, you know, if you want to think about how this might come about, any of us who in the olden days when we traveled, when you would get jet lag, that was an example of your body trying desperately to readjust the body clock. And so once you get on the other side of that, you're fine until you then have to travel back. And so you and I are on opposite sides of the planet right now, right? And so for me to come to you live, that's going to mess with my body clock. And then when I come back, it's going to do the same thing. Shift workers have a similar thing. And then, you know, we talked earlier about, you know, when we were young and clubbing, the fact that we still got up every morning and went to work was probably our saving grace, because that's the kind of thing that kept our body clock in check, that we were alert during the day. So I always say when someone says, oh, I'm a night owl, I say, well, are you really, or are you a self-created one through bad habits? Right.
Right. Yes. Good point. Speaking of which, shall we raise a cup of tea? Because as you say, we are in opposite sense, sort of, you know, it's morning for me, it's evening for you. So we're both connoisseurs of tea and we do love tea sets and teacups, don't we? So you, Donna, for staying up a little bit later for me, and let's have a little drink.
That looks like a lovely spode, is it? Is that a little spode?
Yes, it is actually.
I have a spode in my collection as well.
Oh, lovely. And Burley is one of my favorite brands. Ooh. What are you drinking? I'm drinking Earl Grey.
I drink Orange Pekoe, which is a Ceylon tea.
Sounds beautiful.
It's divine.
Oh, I'm going to have to try that. Now, you've worked with some major corporations, the Ford Motor Company, Nissan Motor Company, Ernst Young, Qantas. And I just wondered, you know, with big companies, huge big companies, are they any different from maybe the bespoke interior design company on Walton Street in W1 in London or something, who has 10 employees, five of them work part-time? I don't know, I'm making all this up. But I wonder if people work differently based upon their external resources or what they have. Do they think differently that, you know, they've got to put in more time? Did you find that maybe leaders and employees saw it differently in how they spent their time?
Look, I don't think so, because I do have a mix of organisations that I work with, and every organisation I go and speak to always starts with a story that says something like, we're very unique here. Our problems are very unique to our interior design business or our airline business or our manufacturing business or engineering business, to which I always say, of course they are. And then it usually still comes down to the same things. So just about in all organisations, a work ethic, a hard work ethic and an urgency ethic exist irrespective of size. And so what I do find is that people do get caught up in a rhythm of the work. The tone is always set by the business owner or the leader or the manager, depending on the size. It's just really a scale thing, just more people doing crazy things versus a small amount of people doing crazy things. And so I would say that in my experience, when I talk to people about how they're managing their capacity, you know, working smarter, structuring their days more effectively, shortening the time of their meetings, irrespective of the size of the organizations, they all say, yes, that's exactly what we need to do. So I think some of our productivity habits are not necessarily a product of where and how we work. It's how we tend to view the world ourselves as individuals, which is why I when I was doing the PR rounds for one of my books, and I know that sounds fairy. I love that I can say that for one of my books.
Well, you have got 10.
Well, so there it is.
You have got
one of the journalists said, so how will your book help change the culture of an organization? And I said, well, I don't really focus on culture in an organization. I write books that help an individual in that moment make their work work. Because I think if we try to change the culture, we're waiting too long and that's just way too hard. But if I'm in a small organization or I'm in a large organization and I want to run a meeting better or I want to structure my day better or I want to manage my energy better, that's how I help. Because again, as I say, I don't know that it's necessarily a product of size of an organization.
Never miss a show by clicking the subscribe button right now. Thank you for your support. You make this podcast possible. Now, back to the show.
Excellent point. But that brings me to the issue of this phenomenon that I found during lockdown when we all had to work remotely. I noticed that in meetings, Teams, Zoom, whatever we were doing, if it was a presentation, any type of meeting, sometimes people would say, you know, people would arrive on time. I'm a stickler for time. Arrive on time. But then the host would say, well, let's wait a bit until more people join. And I always thought, I've managed to arrive on time. A lot of other people are here on time. Why are we being penalized to wait for other? I wonder what that's all about. I don't remember that happening when we used to physically go to meetings. I never, maybe it did. I didn't experience it. But what do you think that's all about? Let's wait until more people come in and then we'll officially start.
Depends on the context of the meeting. Mm. So certainly in my experience in real life, it happened there as well. People would wander in late and some people would say, oh, we're still waiting on Bob. Should we give Bob 5 minutes? And then someone would pick up the phone and say, let's just text Bob and find out where Bob is. Right. So I still think that used to happen. I think we thought it would be better with remote because it's not like I'm running upstairs, downstairs, getting in a lift, getting in a car. I'm literally just clicking from one thing to another. Mm-hmm. But I think overall meetings, first of all, it's because we book them back to back. That's right. The biggest problem. Mm-hmm. So I have a meeting that goes from 9 to 10 and then I've got another one from 10 to 11. So I'm either going to have to leave one early or be at one late. That's the first thing, right? So I'm always in trouble. So that's why I encourage, finish your meetings 5 minutes before the hour. Give people time to do that. But the thing about context is that there are some meetings where we do need everyone there right from the beginning so that we don't have to repeat ourselves. Okay. So that's one aspect. I'm always extremely respectful of those that get there. I'm on time. I'm the person that would rather be an hour early than 5 minutes late. So that's just how I roll, right? And so I always have. But I tend to give people a little more benefit of the doubt because not everyone's like me, unfortunately. Sure. Not everyone's like me. Yeah. And so I do try to say, okay, I get that there are circumstances that might make people late. In some contexts, we can just go and it doesn't matter if they miss the beginning. Right. But in others, we might want everyone on board right from the word go, which is why we might wait a few more minutes.
Yeah, that makes sense. And listeners, I'm referring to Donna's book, The 25-Minute Meeting. So if you guys have read that, if you haven't, go get it, read it. But, this is all covered in that book where your use of time in those meetings, when you've got people gathered for different purposes, is important. And the example I gave, early in lockdown, I felt like, oh, this is not a great use of employees' time either, because the employees are sat doing nothing, just waiting. Now, if they go that you can, and then, you start to mute yourself, you learn, you adjust. So as you say, Donna, everybody's not like somebody like you and myself who would arrive on time. I like to sit down and relax, have a cup of tea, maybe. I like that grace in between having to start something. When I hold workshops, I do the same. But in this book, that's a really good, if you guys are struggling out there with what I just mentioned for myself, but also if you're holding meetings, you might want to read this book because there's some great tidbits about how to utilize your time and also how to hold a 25-minute meeting. It's kind of practical stuff, brilliant stuff. But you mentioned something too, and I've got a quote from Shakespeare that said, better 3 hours too soon than 1 minute too late. And I love that.
Look, I think it's from my father. He was in the military, and he was in the Navy, and he always used to joke when he'd say, if you're late, it's a long swim home because the ship doesn't wait for you when you're in the Navy. And so I think all of our lives we were led with this idea that you're always heading for a ship that's sailing. Mm-hmm. So you may as well, you better be on time. So that's probably where that's come from.
Yes, in my work, I think a lot of our habits came from our parents, the good and even the not so good. So I want to ask you about your inspiration to write. How were you inspired to write books?
I would love to tell you that was some very altruistic, oh my God, amazing flash of inspiration. But actually, I was at a conference and there was a few of my colleagues, and I didn't know, but a few of my colleagues had written books and they were standing up at this conference showing their books. And I was like, when did that happen? And they were like, just been quietly working away. And this was a conference I used to attend every year. And I didn't quite stand up and declare to the whole conference, but internally I went, I'm not coming back to this conference unless I'm holding a book. So it was really one of those awful comparison things where it's like, I'll have what they're having, please. So I wrote my first book really as a result of smart people I admire are writing books. I want to write one too. Hmm. And that first book, I wrote it about content that I really knew standing on my head, because I also wanted to learn about the process of writing and publishing and layout and marketing, because I didn't know anything about writing books. And then I was hooked, utterly hooked. So that was just about 10 years ago. So I've been writing a book every year ever since.
Now, I have to say, you are the prime example of somebody who walks the walk. So you're showing people how to use their time. And for you to accomplish this, it means that you're actually doing what you're writing about. I think that's a prime example. So we always want to look for people who can be inspired. You were inspired by your colleagues, and then we can be inspired by you, because, you know, who writes a book a year? I just interviewed somebody, an architect, who said that she didn't believe in creative writing blocks or creative blocks. She just believed that we judged our work too much. And I actually agree. I do agree with that. I think unconsciously we're so worried about how it's going to come across that we are at a block. We just sit there with a pen or at a computer. But, you know, you're writing about content that a lot of people relate to. And it's based on a lot of the research. So you look it up. And then a lot of it's experience.
Yes, definitely. And, you know, I agree with your colleague that said, I've never experienced writer's block. I've experienced writer's doubt, where I've edited or read too soon. I think it was Hemingway. There's a couple of ways in which Hemingway's quoted. Often it's write drunk, edit sober. But other people will say, I don't do that. But I've learned to write first, edit later. Mm-hmm. So my editor, amazing woman, she says to me, just send me a rubbish draft of your first chapter, just a rubbish one. Don't worry about sending me glory, just a rubbish one. Because her thinking is, you just get stuff out of your head. Mm-hmm. And you're absolutely right. It's the judgment. It's also the fear that people are going to read it and then think you're terrible or something. But I'm here to tell you, this is a secret. I'm going to lean in. Secret for anyone. Hardly anyone reads your books. Just so you know, I'm very honoured that you've read mine. But I've got to tell you, I know there's a pile of people that have my books and have never read them. So I learned a lesson, and I've got a pile of books that I've never read. Oh, they're all mine behind me there, but up here on the shelf I've got a pile. Mm-hmm. So I'm here to tell you that when it comes to writing, write for yourself first. Just get the stuff out there. No one's reading it. They really don't care, and you don't really matter. And I don't mean that in a horrible way. I just mean that's a really useful frame to think about putting your writing. Even if you think about putting a blog on LinkedIn, you know how hard it is to get an audience on LinkedIn? There's like millions of posts every day. No one's reading all of those. So you just start. That's the keys. Just start.
Brilliant advice. Absolutely. And every artist has a creative writing process. And do you have one? Do you have an approach?
Yes. If you're wanting to think about inspiration, I get inspired by the problems people talk to me about. So for the meetings book, it was people saying, oh, my God, I'm in back-to-back horrible meetings all day. Oh, someone should write about that. The next one was that we're constantly in this state of urgency, yet we're still not getting anything done. Oh, maybe I should look into what that's about. And then the more recently is we're overwhelmed, out of control, and at risk of failing at the important things. Okay, I'm going to have a look at what that's about. And, and it was also somewhat inspired by just an off-the-cuff conversation about the 80-20 rule. Around how, you know, 80% of what you do gets you 20% results or whatever, or 20% of what you do gets you 80% of your results. And I was talking to a guy who was an engineer, and he said, no, you should investigate the 15% rule, because there's this real thing around how optimal capacity in engineering, in nature, in sports, in lots of things is 85%. And it was that conversation that got me thinking, oh, I wonder if we could do more or achieve more by doing less. And so I started researching that. So my creative process is typically an inspirational conversation that results in a thought that says, someone should write about that. And so then I go investigating, has anyone written, what's different and unique about what I'm thinking? What's a thinner slice? So meetings is a thick slice, run meetings well. A thin slice is 25-minute meetings. Mm-hmm. So I think, how thin can I get that slice to write a very specific, helpful book? And then it starts with what I think about it, researching what others have said about it, making it match. I remember at university, probably my process hasn't changed since then, a lecturer saying there's no such thing as an original idea, so get over yourself. Mm-hmm. You've always got to kind of back up your thinking with support, and I can usually, you know, so I go looking for that. And then it's bum glue, as we like to call it down here. It's setting myself a I believe that momentum trumps motivation. Mm. And so sitting down and just generating 500 words a day is going to get me a book rather than sitting down and waiting for the muse to descend. So that's typically my process.
Excellent. Just going back to the meeting bit, your first book, The Pen is Mightier Than the Slide, that was published in 2014. I love that title. But I wanted to quickly ask you about that, because in that book you talk a lot about using, you know, flip charts, which I absolutely love, you know, drawing things out, writing things out, mm-hmm. as opposed to death by PowerPoint as such. Is that still relevant today where everybody's online and doing, you know, are people, do you find it still effective just to get out that flip chart, show it online?
I really wish I had it behind me now, but it's actually behind my camera on the other side of the room. I've got a flip chart stand on wheels that I can wheel in behind me and draw on and wheel out. So I still do drawings. I also have an iPad connected with a mm-hmm. pencil, and I can flip my view across to draw on that. So I don't think it's necessarily about banning the slide, because I think it's very useful in virtual context. Mm-hmm. I think it's still about changing it up and mixing it up and being more engaging. So I've got a colleague, a lady called Lynn Cazaley, who I don't think she's used a slide since, if she has, it's not many, since the pandemic started. She always has a flip chart stand behind her and draws out everything. So that book was written, again, as a direct response to just the corporate place of, you know, why would anyone want to go to a meeting just to hear someone read slides? Are you serious?
I know. Absolutely right. Yeah. But I do love that. I like when you talk a little bit about, you know, how it's more about information. And people do ingest a bit more creatively in their mind when they see pictures. That's how you learn.
Well, it shifts, it pulls their attention back in. Hmm. So one of the things I found in my research, particularly with virtual meetings, was that unless you tell people what they're going to, what you need them to do, like basically at 10 o'clock, I'm going to ask you to do something. Mm-hmm. And this is happens in physical meetings as well, but it was more prevalent in virtual. They assume a passive posture. So they join the meeting and they assume they're just there to sit back and listen. And so what happens when you shift to an iPad or a flip chart, or you change something up on the camera, you literally see people lean in. So it just draws their attention back in and has them almost mentally engage with the piece, or mentally participate. I beg your pardon. Yeah.
If you'd like to be a guest on the show, email me at enquire@theinquisitiveren.com. That's enquire@theinquisitiveren.com. Be sure to check all social media, especially the Facebook page, for new topics and new interests. And if you're an expert in the field, I'd love to hear from you. Or if you'd just like to have a chat, contact me. Let's get you on the show. Now, let's get back to the show. This is good stuff. So now I've just read the first 2 hours. And I loved it. It's an audio book, actually. I say I read, I listened to,
because you heard my dulcet tones.
You narrate your own audio books, which is really nice. I love it when the author actually narrates, because it you just get that connection, really. And I love audio books as well. So that was published in 2019, a couple of years ago. And you teach about designing your day, kind of getting your day right, rather than being at the mercy of it as such, you know, like, oh my God, I'm awake. And then all of a sudden you're asleep again. And it's like, where's the day gone? But what I love is your research on neuroscience. I talked about that, but also you talk about energy flow and how we're actually connected, which is, again, up my alley because I do a lot of energy work, but our body clock and everything. So I wanted to ask you, we know you're a great author, but do you do anything sort of, I don't know, metaphysically, you know, energy, meditation, yoga, relaxation? What are your thoughts about that?
Right. I really want to say yes to all those things. Probably one of the best activities that I do just to get my mind in good shape is something called Wipe the Mind most mornings. So I think it was Einstein that first suggested the idea that the mind is for creating or having ideas, not storing them. Mm. So you don't have to remember stuff. Mm. And so probably one of my best processes is every morning, pen and paper, just write everything that I'm thinking about and get everything out of my head. Right. And that kind of clears up space for me to then think and process. I'm a huge fan of breaks. I do tend to take lengthy non-work related breaks throughout the day. And by lengthy, I mean, I don't know, 30 minutes. Mm. So you will never see in my diary back-to-back meetings. You'll usually see 30-minute gaps in between where I get up and stretch and wander around and go outside and pat my dog and make a cup of tea and do all that sort of stuff, get away from my desk. I walk. I think I probably find that's my most... mindful exercise is, and I don't listen to podcasts or anything when I walk. I just walk and be in nature. Because I tried that years ago. I tried the idea of what you would call folding time. So, you know, working in the gaps, being when we thought productive was about multitasking. So go for a walk and listen to a podcast, or go for a walk and listen to an audiobook. And I just don't do any of that. I'm very conscious that if my mind doesn't rest, it's never going to be in the best shape it can be to do the work that I do.
Absolutely. Which brings me to your latest book, The One Day Refund. And when I first read the title, I thought, ooh, can I really get a refund of the time I've wasted? You know, I was quite excited about having a refund of some of the things I thought all the time. But then I thought, like you just said, sometimes it's good to just do nothing. And one of my favorite quotes actually is about you saying, you know, this is going to shock you all, but you don't have to be full out all day, every day. I'm paraphrasing here, the listeners, but so you've got to read the book to get the exact quote. So I wanted you to talk a little bit about the one day refund. Can we get a refund on our time?
Well, I think let's, can your listeners forgive me and let's not go too literal with this. It was more around assuming that a 5-day work week is spoken for and that there's no way I can find other time. Mm. So a lot of people talk about that. They'll come to me and they say, I want to be more productive. I need more capacity. So this word more comes up a lot. So for me, it's not this. I'm not going to say to you, find more. Mm. I'm going to say, work with what you've got. And if you follow a few simple techniques, and, you know, my books are always full of tips and simple techniques, you can pare back so that you can, in effect, get the equivalent over a 7-day period of 7 hours a day back in your time, which you can then use for whatever you need to. Absolutely. And again, and some people read that and think, oh, yay, you know, I'm at work, I get to goof off. I'm like, no, it's really... you know, if your listeners are thinking about any time when a meeting gets cancelled, you know, that feeling, you know, a meeting gets cancelled at the last minute, it's like, that whole hour free.
Yes, yes, yes.
What would you do in that time? That's what this book is around, doing the things that would help you get ahead of the curve and that ultimately gets you your refund down the track.
I see. So, no, that's helpful to know. And actually, you were just in Forbes, so congratulations on that. That was really nice. You were part of a few books that were mentioned about sort of productivity and all that. And I think it was connected to New Year's resolutions write-up. When reading about that, I was grinning from ear to ear when you said, I know if it feels wrong to put in less effort, but rest and relaxation are essential elements to producing your best work. And I was like, Eureka, yes, thank you. It's something I've been telling or trying to help my clients with for 20 plus years. people feel, you know, they're running corporate or they've got the new job, or they've moved to Spain, or they, you know, moved to France, or they, and they think, oh my God, I haven't got time. And it's, how are you going to even give what you need to give if you don't sleep, rest, relax, take a break, hug the cat, kiss your wife, just take a break.
So yeah, I love that. I think it does sound counterintuitive to say, I'm going to say to you, work less hours and you'll end up achieving more. Yeah. People are like, well, how does that work? And then a lot of people will say, I have no control over that. It's the company makes me busy. My boss makes me busy. Our clients make me busy. And I say, well, you know, you actually are the boss of you. You get to determine how you work. And some of the most productive people I've ever met always appear calm under pressure, just seem to be collected. They're not running around like chooks with their heads cut off. In fact, on the contrary, the least productive people I know are the ones working long and ridiculous hours and constantly complain about being busy. In fact, they wear their busyness like a badge of honor. Yes. You know, like, how are you? Oh, so busy. Did 14 hours yesterday. I'm like, that's dangerous.
Yeah.
That's dangerous. You shouldn't be doing it. You know?
That's amazing. I will add here, there was a section on disengaging, which I love. Because I've always been able to do that. And I know people may think it's cold, but when you learn about yourself, when you learn how to value your time, when you learn about boundaries, it's no longer difficult to do. If someone's taking all your time, then you have no time for yourself. And therefore, it's not an even exchange. And you do have to streamline. Well, I believe these are my beliefs. And now I see that they're your beliefs as well. But, you know, you've got to streamline your life. There are people who are in your life for a time, a reason, a season, all that stuff. And I have no qualms about doing that. You know, I don't. Yes, like you, like I read, I have some friends I've known since I was six. And they will always be in my life. But there are people I've known for years and they're no longer in my life. But that's for a reason. And that's the reason part in that saying. And so you do have to streamline your life. But what are your thoughts about that? How did you come to that realization?
Well, part of it came around because a lot. I do work with people, and a few of your people will be listening, that say they don't feel like they have a lot of choice about their work. And so they can't control a lot of the aspects of their work. They are quite at the mercy of that. And maybe they love that, the pace, whatever. There's plenty of people who love that kind of frantic pace. And so then they'll say, what can I do if that's the case? I'm like, well, let's look at your personal life. Where in your personal life can we create space that will allow you to continue to be able to do this amazing job that you love? And so that's where you have to be extremely discerning about where you put your time, energy, and attention. And too many of us get caught up in other people's agendas, and we end up overspending with our time on other people's stuff. And so you have to kind of say, where are the people in my life that create energy when I hang out with them? Rather than have me feeling like I'm stuck on the couch and I've just had the energy vampire sucking on me and I've got nothing left. Now, most often than not, it'll be a small amount of people that you have. And it does feel a bit cold to say you might have to start setting some boundaries and maybe, you know, let go of some relationships or maybe not engage as much or say no to invitations. I'm a huge fan of people talk about FOMO, fear of missing out. I love JOMO, the joy of missing out, right? Yes. I just love it. So
it's in the book, so by the way. Yeah.
I might just be one of those people. Look, it could even be Navy life. I went to 9 schools in 9 years, moving around a lot. And so I actually have, maybe it was a survival mechanism as a kid to disengage from previous relationships and move on to new ones a little easier. As you said before, we can't underestimate the power of our childhood in terms of driving our adult behaviors. So it could be that. But I would encourage, there's a little tool in there in the book, which is a relationship audit. And it just asks you a few questions about the key people you're hanging out with. And that might help you make some decisions around, you know, do I continue investing? And it's an investment. Do I continue investing here or do I look at investing in other ways?
Yes. Yes. I love that little tool in that book. Yeah. Brilliant stuff. And I will just add to that, a lot of times your family may have put some unconscious ideas, their family, keep reacting, keep in touch, keep doing that. And meanwhile, they're tearing you to bits. So this includes family as well. I'm just going to say that. Well,
but that's okay. The tough one, right? Yes. It's tough to figure out that, particularly some cultures have lots of great demands, familial demands. And when you're trying to hold down a job, let's just be very kind of, generalist here, but if you're holding down a job in a Western culture and you've got Eastern family demands, just that on its own, if you're working really hard and having to then, I had a woman recently say to me, she's one of my coaching clients. This weekend, it's little Bobby's birthday, her nephew. So I've got to bake brownies for that. And then I've got family coming over for dinner. So I've got to prepare dinner for that. And then it's Aunt Agnes's birthday on Sunday. So I've got to make a cake for that. I'm like, girlfriend, buy donuts. Let me introduce you to Uber and pick up a cake from the cheesecake shop on your way over. Why do you have to make all this stuff? Right? It's still okay to meet the family obligations, but why do you have to make all this palaver about it? And she was looking for permission. It was like, permission granted. She says, really? I can buy brownies? Of course you can. Permission granted.
Amazing. But I love that. Great stuff. And also what you've just demonstrated was the quintessential coach, which I wanted to ask you about, what you offer, all your services that you offer. But that's what a coach does. A coach points out what you're missing. It's very different than counseling. It's very different than psychotherapy. We're not looking back. We're looking forward in coaching, which I love. I do both. And there, I try and tell people there is a huge difference. So what you just described is quintessential coaching. Brilliant stuff. What do you offer in terms of coaching? What can people get if they wanted to come to you for coaching?
So I, like many coaches, I have a straight up program. Usually I'll want to filter why are you coming to me? Typically I'm the productivity coach. So you're coming to me because there's stuff you're not getting done that you want to, or you're feeling overwhelmed, out of control, and you're at risk of failing at the important things. So we'll talk about that. I have typically the smallest engagement I'll do with you is six sessions because I feel like I need that to kind of get into it. But most of my clients hang around for 12 months. And so as with any coaching arrangement, I'm sure you're the same. We set some clear goals. We set some boundaries. We set some intentions and we do the work, basically.
Excellent stuff. Yes. And if people wanted to, they just go to your website and fill out an inquiry.
Well, I shouldn't say like all. I was told once I was a shameless self-promoter, and I think they thought that that was an insult, but I took it as a compliment. I'm on all social media. You can reach out to me on LinkedIn or Facebook or Twitter or Instagram. The best way to get me is email, and my email is d@donnamcgeorge.com. And my website is donnamcgeorge.com. All of those things. I've got a very unique name. Yes, Google Donna McGeorge. You'll find me. It's pretty easy to find me.
And all the links will be in the show notes, by the way, viewers. So they'll be on YouTube and everything. So just look below. They're all there. But that's brilliant. Now, I want to ask you just a little bit off course here. What's the best compliment you've ever received?
Oh, wow, that's putting me on the spot. Probably the one I just that jokingly told you about around the I'm a shameless self-promoter. But when it comes to my work, it's probably around my work. I'll answer that from the perspective of it's around how I just seem to get, you always just seem to get stuff done beyond more than what people expect, and it's always done cheerfully, gracefully, happily. And so I love that the legacy I'm leaving for my daughter is around that she's not a daughter that's grown up seeing work is hard and horrible and you complain about it. Work is something to be loved and enjoyed. And so that's probably the compliment I get is around you just seem to do stuff with so much cheer and grace and happiness.
That's amazing. So have you ever had, it's something I ask all my guests, have you ever had to fly above something in life?
Yes, I think it's the question that, I don't know why, it probably comes more on social media when you'll post a piece of work and there's always the question that someone says, who are you to write about this? What are your credentials? How dare you put yourself out there in this way? And I think this is what you mean by this. I kind of have to rise above that and go, like, I remind myself, I've written a bunch of books, I've done the research, I'm all good, and that I don't have to be liked by everyone. I think that was a really big realization for me that, in fact, I'm not to everyone's taste. There might even be, dare I say it, there might be people listening today that go, yeah, she was all right, not that good. And I have to be okay with that, because on the flip side, you know, to your earlier question around a great compliment, heaps of people love me and I'd much rather put my energy in that direction than worry. But knowing that not everyone will love me and like what I do, and, you know, and that's okay.
Yeah, that's a really good one. And, you know, people, that's their stuff. I always think that there's something about them that's going on there. So I like to turn it back on to them. What's happening to them that they've got to log
in? I'm curious. How is their life such that they feel like that's an appropriate response to something? And again, not in an offensive way, like a genuine, I'm genuinely curious that's how they do their world. Mm-hmm. Like, wow. That's very interesting.
Yes, absolutely. On the internet of all places, but yeah. So now this is a segment, because we're coming to the end, where we put a fork in it, far out random question. You know, there's this old saying, put a fork in it. So I'm going to choose from a bowl here. I don't want people, it's actually a little bowl. I'm going to choose, and it really is random. Okay, got one.
Very worried.
Don't worry, it's random. Oh, this is very random. If you had to walk away from one technology in life, what would it be? Ooh.
Television.
Oh, that's interesting.
I quite admire people that say we don't have a television in our house. Mm. I think I would love to live in a world where, you know, now could I do, I mean, I could just not watch telly, I get that, but I also live with a husband who loves telly and he loves sport, but I think that's one technology I could easily live without.
Wow, and that didn't take you long to think about. Yeah. Have you always sort of not been watching telly?
I lived in China for a couple of years. I went up in 2012 and 13 and lived up in Shanghai, and my husband didn't come. So we had a property that was hard to leave behind, you know, old dogs, and it's not like you can just rent it out 20 acres and have someone take care of it while you're away. So we made the decision to have a, you know, distance marriage for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And while I was up there, I hardly watched any television.
Wow.
Partly because most of it was in Chinese, and to get some, you know, you just didn't get the usual TV arrangement that we would get. And so I read a lot of books. I spent a lot of time chatting with people on, back then it was Skype, I would be chatting with people. And so after 2 years of not having much telly, that's probably where it's come from.
Yes, excellent stuff. Well, I mean, see, that wasn't bad. It's just random.
No,
I like to switch it up a little bit. Donna, thank you so much for being on the podcast. I've really enjoyed speaking to you, and your work really speaks to the depths of my soul. I have to say, productivity, it's great.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thanks so much for joining me today. Be sure to follow on all podcast platforms, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you're listening. Also, check all social media, especially the Facebook page, as there'll be new topics listed and new guests. And also Twitter will always have the new and upcoming episodes. But make sure you subscribe so that you never miss an episode. See you soon.